The topic of our podcast, day three versus day five embryo transfer, is still a controversial issue with no common consensus yet reached. Early studies have failed to show significant difference between day three, 8 cells, and day five, ET, where HCG levels, clinical pregnancy, implantation, thinning and early pregnancy loss rates are concerned, resulting in individualized specialist approach. But first, let's just go back to the basics and review the sequence of events taking place after ovulation. On day 14 of a 28-day cycle, the oocyte, egg, is released from the ovary and picked up by the fimbria, finger-like projections of fallopian tube. The egg is moved along passively by the ciliated endothelial cells of the fallopian tubes towards the uterus. If on its way it's met and fertilized by sperm, it becomes the zygote, the very first cell of a whole new organism, consisting of the combined maternal and paternal genome. Following a series of identical mitotic divisions, the embryos both reset solely on the oocyte's potential to become a mass of 6-8 undifferential cells by day three. Thereafter, the embryo's own genomic activation, this mass of cells, develops into the blastocyst. By day five, the blastocysts have a fluid filled cavity surrounded by a layer of differentiated trophoblastic cells, which will form the placenta and an inner cell mass that will eventually become the fetus. By day five, the blastocyst has entered the uterine cavity, and in the next day or so, it will hopefully manage to hatch out of its prospective protein called zona pellucida and successfully implant into the receptive endometrium. During IVF, the oocytes are picked up by ultrasound-guided transvaginal aspiration on the designed day. They are appropriately prepped, evaluated, and fertilized in the lab. The embryos produced are put under close supervision and strict lab conditions in specially designed cultivation media and incubators. The latter, the so-called time-lapse incubators, allow their 25-hour observation. All developing embryos seem to pose on day three and day five, allowing us to evaluate their dynamic state and select the best-looking ones based on specific morphological criteria for transfer into the uterine cavity via the cervical canal and onto the well-prepped biprogesterone endometrium. Some IVF specialists argue that day three embryo transfer is preferable in older and poor responders with low number of good quality embryos. In this instance, day three embryo transfer is less expensive with no risk of losing good embryos by culture and can potentially yield better cumulative pregnancy rates, as studies have shown that even borderline quality embryos transferred on day three may potentially lead to pregnancy compared to no embryos transferred. Nowadays, however, and in clinics such as ours, with extensive experience in the cultivation process and excellent blastocyst survival, following the vitrification process, day five embryo transfer makes much more sense even in poor responders. In labs, when the blastulation rate index is over 60% and the possibility of achieving the blastocyst stage is high, day five embryo transfer is favored. Allowing the embryo to reach the blastocyst stage allows us to make an educated guess on the embryos that have the highest potential to survive and successfully implant, thus avoiding futile attempts at transferring day three embryos destined to arrest and reducing the time needed to achieve a successful pregnancy. Additionally, day five embryo transfer offers patients with transparency, giving them a clear view of available embryos which are of the best quality since they survived and grew through the biological selective process. But what if the embryos which are available on day three are of very poor quality? Isn't a good idea to carry out the embryo transfer on day three rather than waiting till day five? In the group of fresh cycle followed by fresh embryo transfer, day three transfer is an acceptable decision for us, long as it is accompanied by a detailed discussion about the expected implantation success rates. However, in the case of frozen cycles, which nowadays account for more than 70% of all cycles, day five transfer is the preferred approach to ensure that only the best quality embryos will be vitrified, thus yielding better pregnancy rate or subsequent transfers. Lastly, day five embryo transfer reduces biopsy embryo loss rates. Performing a trophoctoderm biopsy during PGT prenatal genetic testing in day five allows us to extract more cells, consequently improving the accuracy of the genetic diagnosis with concomitant lower risk on embryo viability compared to whole blastoma extraction during day three biopsy. From our own experience, day five PGT have higher clinical pregnancy and live birth rates compared to day three, especially on FRET cycle. In summary, day five embryo transfer shows to be more transparent for the patients and reproductive scientists, giving them a clear view as it acts as a biological filter on embryo quality. In the era of total freezing strategy, which includes 70% of all performed cycles, day five frozen embryo transfer shows higher percentage of clinical pregnancy, reaching up to 50%. In our lab, the survival rate after blastocyst thawing is over 95% and strongly supports the use of frozen blastocysts. Day 5 blastocyst embryo stage makes it easy to use the NGS next generation techniques during prenatal genetic testing, which shows to be the new trend in reproductive medicine. By transferring the euploid blastocyst, we achieve over 60% in clinical pregnancy rate.